going to concentrate on collective memory, because Son of Saul was very much built on the collective memory. So this is what I'm trying to show you, that what are the segments, what are the parts, what we were building on our movie. And then I'm going to show, hopefully we will have time, a little bit the sources of Son of Saul, what were the main aspects of the research. And then some of the pictures taken during the shooting of the movie, during making it, and at the end, that what are the reactions all over the world about Son of Saul, briefly. So I'm trying. I'm going to do my best. So the whole thing started with Adorno. Certainly, most of you know these sentences. It's from 49. When he told, and even he had a stronger sentence, but I just didn't want to put the last sentence, which is that after the Holocaust, this is the end of the history. Because then you would guess that Fukuyama wasn't, how should I say, okay, doesn't matter. So it's, they debated very much this, thinkers, philosophers, writers debated very much these sentences, if it's right or not. But certainly it reflects very much the unbelievable shock of the survivors, of us, of killing, of murdering 6 million people, innocent people. And I think this sentence reflects that very much. And there are other versions of the Eredita, which is also, I think, a nice phrasing of this dilemma. That if art exists after Auschwitz, but immediately at the end of the 40s, there were poems, novels, actually French poet Charlotte, who is a survivor, and he started to write poetry, and last but not least, Claude Lanzmann. I don't know if you know his name. He's the famous film director who made Shoah. It's a more than nine hour movie, and mostly or almost all of the all parts are interviews with survivors, not only survivors but also some of the Nazis. And it's a basic movie. And he is one of the persons who says that he made the movie in 85, as far as I remember, and he is the person who says that there is no art. Whatever you do, it could be only a documentary, it could be based on only on eyewitnesses, nothing else is unacceptable. So he's very strict. And he introduces a word, because he says that victim is an appropriate word for the people who died during the Holocaust. He says that the only word is revenant. He's French, so because it has a double meaning, it's not only someone who revient, but also it means ghosts. So he talks about the missing persons from our society, those who are just ghosts, but they are around us. So this is what his whole, he was in the group of Simone de Beauvoir and Sartre and all this gang, so to say. So he's a very outstanding and very, very strong personality, even now, even today. But I just showing you that, of course, no one kept the words of Adorno, and there are a lot of books were published. And just I told you, just touching sometimes that there are two Nobel Prize winners, Curtis and Eliezer, among. But these are all very good books. And naturally, other parts of our culture of art. People were very active commemorating and adding something to the perception of the Holocaust. These are the composers who directly wrote, not just reminding, but directly wrote and dealt with the. And as you see from the composers from the who started at the 30s, until Steve Rajk and Nono, which are basically contemporary composers. Artists, cultures, and other people, of course, they were dealing with the Holocaust. That's Picasso, the middle one is also Picasso, that's Fernand Léger, and this is Chagall. Just again, to give you hints. Some of them, it is discussed that it's not directly the Holocaust, but as you see from the pictures, there are some parts of it which reminds us. This one is an exceptional, because this is a fresco from Auschwitz. And because painters, sculptors were among the deportees, and Königgraben, it means ditch, I think, no? But what they are digging out for the water, it's ditch?
Ditch.
Okay, so it's the king's ditch, the title. And this is actually not in Auschwitz, but in Birkenau, when a lot of deportees were forced to maintain the camp. You will see I will show you where it was in the camp. So it's a spontaneous piece of art. We don't know, of course, the person who drew it. It's rather big. It's something like 3 meters by 2 meters. So it's not just a small picture. It's a real fresco in one of the attics of Auschwitz, in one of the barracks. Continuing it, and now we are starting to get a little bit deeper in this very special art, what I was trying to choose. At the liberation of the camps, both armies, I mean the Red Army and the American Army, they had the order to investigate immediately, and because they knew about, and I will tell you why they knew about. So those armies approaching and liberating the camps, they started immediately the investigation. On the one hand, they recorded it. On the other hand, there were again some artists who immediately started to make sketches. So these are like photographs, and these drawings helped us a lot to do the movie, because these drawings were made, I don't know, a month, 2 weeks, 2 days later, as they were liberated. This is as you see the what happens at the gas chamber. This is the gas chamber was in the basement, and the furnished room where they burned the dead bodies, it was one floor higher up. They used a freight elevator, what you see there. And these are the corpses, and these are the ovens. The probably it's, forgive me that sometimes I'm very objective, because it's very hard to talk about such things, but believe me, it's hard for me as well, not only for you. Thank you. So when the corpses are burned, not all the parts are burning. So not all the parts becoming ash. But this part, the muscles, you know, this kind of thing, sometimes the skull, so they have to crush it to make a powder out of it. And then we will see how they deposited, so to say, the ash. Also, I think that it could be said that it's also a kind of spontaneous monument of Auschwitz. This is in Birkenau, and before the Red Army arrived to Auschwitz in 45, January 20-something, 25th, I think, or 26th, but the Nazis left the camp before in December, and they blew up everything because they wanted to eliminate all the traces what was going on in Auschwitz. Actually, that's today. This is how it looked like when the army arrived. This is again a photo taken a couple of days later as they arrived to not to Auschwitz but to Birkenau, and this became a monument. This is also, I would say, it's a kind of a spontaneous monument. Not made for that, but it became the kind of a reminding us what was happening in the. And naturally, the kind of, if I could say, if I could use this word, this is the brand of the Holocaust, this sentence in Auschwitz,
which is again, you know, it became a monument.
It wasn't made for a monument, but it became because
we, all of us, made it to a monument.
So this is what I call kind of collective memory, that even collective memory could produce piece of art like this. And as you know, they're using it everywhere. This is in the Washington Holocaust Museum. Naturally, it's not only a spontaneous monument, but immediately, there are no photographs, or at least I couldn't find any of them. But it's reported. You can read about that. Deportees, survivors. Before leaving the camp, they were putting up small little stone monuments. But this is the monument in Birkenau. This is the kind of central monument in Auschwitz. So the kind of memorial culture immediately started, and you can see that it's a kind of a struggling of the artist to be abstract. So this is what this period is called, some of the historians who know much better all these things than me, they call this period the amnesy, which is that people didn't really talk about. There were very few oral history about those people who survived. They rather wanted to forget, which is absolutely understandable, because this is a kind of a self-defense of survivors. So it's reflected very much in the monuments that they are very, very abstract. It's just commemorating something, but these are not narrative monuments. Things like that. So you will see very weird things. You know, this is in Kazakhstan, I think. This is Dachau. And sometimes it's always kind of, I think it's a kind of a self-defense, a protection, that this horrible, horrifying thing is kind of, it's in an abstract level. We don't really see, the artists don't really show what it's all about. It's just a commemoration. So I'm not telling, you know, all the, you know, where they are. This is in Croatia. This is Yad Vashem. This is in the States. I don't remember. And also you can see, you know, the kind of elements which started to be canonized in this monument. And this is in Czechoslovakia, Czech Republic. And it was in Czechoslovakia when it was carried out. But okay, these are weird things. This is also a Holocaust monument. It's in Szombathely in Hungary. This is again, you know, And also now you can see the different elements what artists try to use, you know, the broken tablets of Moses, and you know, the David Star, the broken wall of Jerusalem, etc. So it's, you know, they start to build up a kind of but then there are very, this is in Rio de Janeiro. This is in Sao Paulo. This is, you know, as you see, the architect was forming, you know, the... This is in Shanghai. This is in Brazil, I don't know which town. This is Hyde Park. This is in Minsk, former Soviet Union. This is Berlin. This is the Roma monument. This is in Montevideo. So as you see, they try to keep it very abstract, and it's really concentrating on the commemoration, nothing else. And naturally, you know, in the Soviet Union, sometimes they have gigantic things. Look at that. So you can feel the scale of it. It's in Lithuania. The more or less at the same phase in the 50s, 60s, some naturalistic statues started to appear, you know, as monuments. and they concentrate very much on the tragedy. And these are very, very naturalistic, of course, most of them. This one, the last three one was in Paris. This is in Père Lachaise. This is again Père Lachaise. This is in Germany. This is in Miami Beach. And that's a beautiful one. Because you have to walk into this artificial island. And then you will see, it's a kind of, how should I say, well, it's a wrong word, but it's a kind of interactive statue that you get very close to it, and you can touch it. And I'm showing you what you see. You can call it a cage, but certainly it shows very strongly, it really punches into your face that what it's all about. I wouldn't ever do such a monument, but I have to... Yes, Jesus, yes. It's, I mean, it's a whole little... I don't know. Okay, here you are. So it does something, but it's not my cup of tea. Okay, the other same time, as you know, as the perception was getting broader and broader, after some time by the 60s, especially in Eastern Europe, its state socialism couldn't stand that they are loser, that they are not victorious. So they started to shift the whole perception to resistance. So there were a whole series of monuments, which was they weren't concentrating anymore on the tragedy. It's not something abstract. It's the resistance, and it's not only in Eastern Europe. So this is one of the examples. This is another one, the victorious deportees. And as I told you, it's not only in Eastern Europe. So there was a very interesting shift how to transform a tragedy into victory, which is at the end of the 60s, this is, so as I told, the first phase, what we call amnesty, the next phase, what experts are kind of worked out the cluster, this is the period of questions. Two very important questions. This is young corn bandy, by the way. And so the two basic questions is that, hey father, what were you doing? You understand, I don't think I need to explain, especially in a German context. It's a very, very crucial, merciless question. What were you doing? And this is the end of the 60s. The other question is also as well merciless, I think. It's that how it happens that there are three Nazis and they are driving thousands of Jews into the gas chamber and there is no revolt against these three young guys. This is also a merciless question, and basically it's even harder to answer to this question than the first one. So this is the so through these questions and through many of those which were built on the two previous ones, the most important thing is that which came out of it, that it's not only people who are murdered, it's not 6 million human beings, they have names, they have addresses, they have families, they have children, so let's personalize them. So that this is the period when the personalization of the Holocaust started, which led us to the technique of the Washington Holocaust Museum, where you can get a name and you can follow the fate of those people you have, of that family you got at the entrance, what happens to them, how they arrive to the United States, to America, what happens there, the other part stays in Europe, etc. So it's a very complicated system, but really brings you as a personal friend, acquaintance, someone
whom you are following. And then, you know, there's an endless thing. This is the same period, if you think about the Vietnam Memorial. It also operates with names. So those are not just soldiers, they have personality. And it's very important, you know, to give a person to those people. And it goes, as I mentioned, the Washington Museum, they found in Lithuania a small photographic gallery, and they found all the negatives. So this is what they did from these negatives. So it's not only a name, but also it's really a person with a face. And this is the end of that gallery. Contemporary artists started to also operate this. This is Sega. It's not just a tragedy, but it's something again. You know, it's abstract and not, but these are persons whom we see in this monument. They are already in the 90s. So I'm not going in chronological. It's rather topic by topic what I'm trying to tell. This is. German artist, and this is the stumbling stones. This is how we call it. These are the stones which are laid in front of those on the cobblestone street, in front of those houses where he lived. So it's again, it's not anymore just a person with the face, but with an address. So we're adding all these other elements to our like this. This is in Italy. And there is one little cobblestone here. This is all the countries which started to work together with the German artist. So you have everybody in these countries, this kind of hit. It's almost a hidden monument, but it's there. So it's in our street, in front of my house, there is also a... And which is important because I have a friend who never buys anything second-hand in Germany, because he says, I don't know who was the original. In Europe, as I mentioned, in front of my house, there is a store. I don't know the family. I never, and you know, I'm sitting on the same, I don't know, stair. I'm using the same stone, I'm using the same doorknob. It's a, if you start to think about it, it's a kind of an endless thing. And it's, so it's a very, how should I say, very smart monument. Because it's not oppressing, it's not something big and you have to commemorate. It really gets into your mind and it's always there, somewhere. Now we go over a little bit for the commemoration of the other aspect that in some cases the artists and exhibitions like this I mean it's my exhibition, so I tried I designed this exhibition. We tried to that the visitors experience a little bit what was happening. This was a so-called museum technique in the 80s and 90s. You have to go through a sandy floor, you have to go across that's a real cattle wagon which is there, and then you arrive to the end of the exhibition, which is a kind of an installation that the names were reading up constantly. Those people who had been killed, murdered during the Holocaust. I will return to this problem: how to finish a Holocaust exhibition. What is the last moment? This one, which is a kind of a meditative space, which gives you a kind of a time to think it over, and then you leave. Or there is another one. I will show you. This is in the Washington Museum. It's also, you know, tries to make you experience what was happening
with our with the human beings who then got murdered. So it, it kind of goes through with you the exhibition. So it's you know, the first laws against the Jews, then the deportation, then arriving to Auschwitz, then the bombs in the in the in the camp. This is a more modern version. This is the first Holocaust exhibition got opened in Moscow, in Russia, before Putin. It wasn't Putin who did it. And but it's, I mean, it's a little bit, you know, this means, it's the, so they try to refer the good old times. So this is the Soviet culture and science. You know, this shows that how many Jews were involved in this. And again, this is, you know, this is the kind of what I mentioned already, the kind of personalization. So it's not just photographs, it's not just, but sometimes pictures. And you see, they, it seems that they made a research just like me, so they found Segara. And also, you can, on a touch screen, you can feel yourself in the cinema, as you see. And then this is the end of the exhibition. So this is the kind of, as I told you, to create an atmosphere, to create an ambiance, which teaches you, which somehow grabs your mind that what was happening. The next, so we went through to the amnesy part. We went through now these questions. And the last two groups or clusters is we could define that more and more art historians and historians are telling that art and artists are not reacting to the original event, to the Holocaust, but they're reacting to the pieces which had been done just before. So it's and as you if you see, this is in Berlin, the big monument. This is like the stumbling stones, just gigantic. But it's almost like, so it's, you know, it's really starting to. This is the inside. This is Daniel Leveskin. This is his museum in Berlin, the Jewish Museum. And as you see, he again, now we are getting sometimes almost blasphemy, because this is the smile, but it's not a smile. So he starts to use, you know, this kind of, this is my exhibition in what I designed in Auschwitz. This starts to deal with the missing cultural parts, the missing persons. It indicates that nothing is, so not even the photographs are materialized. Everything is projected, as you see. This is in, again, still, you know, dealing with the missing person. This is in Budapest. This is the embankment of the Danube, where Jewish, Hungarian Jewish, where the Jews were driven down from the ghetto to the Danube, and then shot into the Danube, but they always had to leave their shoes, because their shoes were collected there. This is a new kind of fashion. Descendants, grandsons, grandchildren start to use the same tattoo what their grandparents had. This is in, now we are getting really tough. This is a Polish artist called Libera, who started to design Lego, so you can build your own little concentration camp out of Lego. And unbelievable scandal. And then, a couple of months later, Lego accepted. And now there is in museums, you know, this as a piece of art, that you can do your own little concentration camp. This is mine. It's not so tough. This is mine.
This is this commemorates. There was not a competition. The organizer asked a couple of artists to commemorate to the deportations. At the beginning, the all the people who arrived to Auschwitz, they got a postcard, namely Wannsee, and they had to send home that we are okay, we arrived, it's beautiful, blah 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 blah. And so this is my postcard, and if you cut it out, you can build your own little crematorium. This is the very famous Spiegelman the mouse, which is I think now we accept it and now we tolerate it, and even some people like it. But think about, I don't know, 20, 30 years ago, that Jews are the mouse and the Nazis are the cats. And this is how, and it's, you know, it's a kind of an educational book. This is Boltanski, I think I don't need to explain. This one easier. This is you can read, but this is, you know, the Norwegians as a resistance they were using on the colors clips, and then they started to use it to protest, and so the students decided to collect 6 million paper clips, and they're going to make a monument out of it. This is the hardest. This is Barbies are the Jews, Kens are the Nazis. It's naturally it's in California. And they are marching in normal ovens. Okay. So this up to this, these are the monuments, and now I'm shifting to, do I have time? Yeah. Okay. Now I'm shifting that what were the sources of Son of Saul? And what are the novelty, what is new in Son of Saul? First of all, the topic. The Sonderkommando is a unit in the concentration camps. They are receiving the people just arriving as deportees. They are accompanying them to the changing rooms, undressing rooms, then to the gas chamber. And when the gas chamber, when all those people murdered, they are the ones who are taking out the corpse, putting into the freight elevator, going up to the furnace room, and then burn. So we have very, very few piece of art concerning the Sonderkommando. This is still something very touchy, very hot potato. So you can never know if they are victims or they are just cold-blooded murderers. Still, you know, there is not an agreement that everybody agrees upon this. So it's still something what we have to deal with, what we have to discuss. So this is as the Sonderkommando is just working, because they are not they were throwing dead bodies not only into furnaces but in open pits. What I'm doing? Yeah, sorry. Okay, the other, so this is the topic, which is very new, and most of it, it's not shocking, but it's kind of, yeah. And the other one is that if you think about, it's the movie language. The movie language changes very much in Son of Saul. I could sum it up that at the beginning, we build huge set, this is Griffiths, Intolerance, and in this huge set, the director saw the set, the actor saw the set, cinematographer saw the set, and we, the audience, saw the set. This was going on, I would say, until the 90s. Next phase, that we build huge green boxes, two guys are fencing with a piece of wood, so the director doesn't see the set, cinematographer doesn't see the set, the actors don't see the set, we, the audience, we see, and we know it's a spaceship, and it's Star Wars, and they are just fencing with the lasers. And this is Son of Saul. which means that we built the set, the cinematographers see the set, the directors see the set, actors, and we don't see the audience. But we understand. And this is the trick in it, that how to, because most of the Holocaust movies are kind of narrative movies. They explain us, they show us the barracks, the endless number of barracks and the people, the tragedy, the torture, the suffering. This one does not show. We don't see any of it. We only hear. And I mean, this technique was applied in many movies, but in this movie, it's from the first second to the last. And I was very skeptical if it's worked, I have to tell you. And then my young friend, the director, drew my attention to the part of Magic Mountain Thomas Mann. Those who read certainly remember when our protagonist, or one of the protagonists, Hans Castor, is sitting in the dining room, backing the door. This is back to the door, and all of a sudden he hears that someone slams the door. And he knows it's Madame Shosha. Without looking at, just from the noise, he knows it. He knows it's a glass door. He knows it's a double-wing glass door. He knows everything, just from the noise. And so this is the trick in this movie, that the noise was the kind of my colleague as a visual designer. It described the space, and also, you know, that you need them to see the space, because you from your movements, I know that it's a narrow corridor, and you move differently than in a wide corridor. Or you climb differently a steep step than a normal step. So there are a lot of things when you don't see the space that you understand. And this is the trick in this movie, that you never see the space. You never see, it's always blurred. Mm-hmm. But you understand the whole structure of this death factory. And this was the kind of goal, to concentrate on the man, on the person, and not on the surroundings, because you understand it without seeing. Okay, this is now we galloping fast. This is Auschwitz. This is the so-called mother camp. This is where you have the museum and the Arbach Machfrei. This is how it started. It started in 1939. These were military barracks from the Austro-Hungarian Empire. And they transformed it into an interrogation center. And the first deportees arrived in 40, 41. So it started as an interrogation center. This is what they built after. This is Birkenau. So this is what they wanted to realize. This was the goal. This was the end goal. This is just a kindergarten comparing that. This is on the same scale, as you see, the same size of the building look at that. What's the difference? And our movie takes place here, up there. And so this is where the people arrive on the ramp. And that's the women's section. This is the Russian prisoners of war section, and this is mixed. And this was the Roma section, and they wanted to develop onto here. They wanted to develop it to 200 something thousand. And if anybody, anywhere you read that an architect doesn't know that it's a death camp, don't believe. I mean, from the layout, from the number of toilets, from the latrines, from the number, from the size of the kitchen, you know it's a death camp. So it's, and think about, you know, the everyday action when one of my colleagues gets up, takes a shower, and meanwhile thinking about how to make more effective the crematorium. This is an engineer, it's professionally done. Okay, the other source, so this is the sources,
This is the archive. This is actually, as I told my colleague, an architect, Julie. This is where you, the undressing room, the big ones. 3,000 people was driven there at once. Then as they undressed, they always telling them to remember the numbers of the hangers, etc., etc., because as you finish your shower, the coffee would be ready and you can get dressed back, etc., etc. Then they went here. This is the gas chamber, which is again another colleague who camouflaged it into a shower, very professional work. And that's the entrance. And as they were killed, that's the freight elevator on the upper corner. And this is the furnace room. And this is the other doctor's room, etc., etc. So this is the archive itself. It was a very important source. Second, in Auschwitz, the Nazis did a kind of photographic story. It's called the Auschwitz album, which means that professional photographers started to make all the phases of killing. And this is one of the photographs. This is as they arrived. The third one, the Sonderkommando itself. This is called the Auschwitz protocol. The Sonderkommando made four photographs, clandestine photographs. This is one of them. And it's also very important photograph because this was going on between Didier Huberman and Claude Lanzmann. I mentioned them. It's a documentary photograph. It's pure. Even Lanzmann accepts it. And then the question is that, what are they talking about? These guys. You see that they're discussing something. What is the matter of the discussion? How to take apart the dead bodies? Who going to lift the other one? What is the subject of these guys doing? What these guys doing? Doesn't want to step on a face? Or why he's balancing, or he's just falling over? Or what this guy is doing? So this was the big question to Lanzmann. That okay, we accept that only documentary, but then explain us this photograph. This is the other photograph. You see here. As I told the liberators immediately started to make investigations, but also they staged things. So this is after the liberation, and they asked the member of the Sonderkommando to show them how the process was delivering. So this is the archive itself, the Auschwitz album, Auschwitz protocol, the investigators, and this one. Actually, this was we were working with László in the Torbjörn movie in Corsica. And I don't know, the shooting was postponed, and we found the book in a small bookinist. And the book was about this guy. These are called the scrolls. And these are diaries of the Sonderkommando who were writing down precisely what they were doing, how many they were, what they were eating, how many people they burned, etc., etc. And then they put them in tin cans and buried on the courtyard of the crematoriums. And they were, the first one was found back in 62. And then gradually they started, because they didn't want to dig, they didn't want to make archaeological investigations around the crematoriums, because when I mentioned that they were depositing the ashes, it means that they were just throwing up. So even nowadays, if you walk around in Birkenau, basically you are still walking on ashes. So this is already the shooting, the movie. This is what you see. These instruments were, anyway, I'm just running through. This is the undressing room.
the gas chamber, freight elevator, doctors, this is the furnace room, everything was built. This is the actual shooting. This kind of photograph, pictures you don't see in the movie, because as I told you, everything is blurred. You don't really see. But this is the reality. So, this is the young guy. So just imagine that I'm designing a door. Let's say the gas chamber door. It shouldn't be, you know, like a big tooling door, because it's a gas chamber. And all these guys had to get through. And they are running backwards. This one, the cameraman. This guy, now he's very much, let's say, shy, because generally he holds like this, because basically he's running, and cinematographer don't see anything, he just trusts this guy. And then there is the focus holder, you see only the hand. This is the guy who makes the focus on the right place, and in such a movie then, when the camera is here, it's very important if the focus is here, or here, or here, or somewhere. So it's an unbelievable job what he did, running backwards. I'm always emphasizing, running backwards. And imagine the protagonist, he's not an actor. And the camera constantly here for 30 days in his face. So this is shooting. So I think we are going to suggest to make an Oscar for the focus puller. Okay, these are the opening. This is the gas chamber. And as you see, you know, we really, you know, we're using those sketches. This is the furnace room. The ashes were deposited on the one hand around the crematorium, on the other hand there is a small river called Shoah, and they were throwing, and this is, you know, how it... This is the reconstruction of very much of that photo that I showed you. This is the last picture. Okay, this is our... Give him a hand. He's a very nice guy. I told you, young. So he really merits it. He is the one, you know, who merits it. This is the camera guy. Also. So you see the energy of these guys. It's really fantastic. I really like that. Okay, this is... because this is very important. Lansman and Lili Ullermann, who hated each other because of their debate, but it's a very serious debate, and because of the movie, they are friends. So Ullermann wrote an essay on the movie, and Lansman, he's 90-something now, it's an old photograph, and he went on to Cannes, and he said, here's my grandson. Okay, sorry, I forgot to mention that this is the Golden Globe. And that's the Oscar, that's Khan. What he holds in his hands. But Germany, they didn't like the movie at all. Very serious journals were really, really criticizing very much. That it's a kitsch, that it's useless to talk. I don't want to simplify. In Germany, it's very hard to criticize a Holocaust movie, which makes a world success. So there is one explanation that because of this novelty, because of the topic, it somehow ruins that image, what they built up. And without the Germans, this movie wouldn't have been done, for sure. Without all this, you know, because they're really very serious about it. But somehow this movie they didn't write at all. So So I'm not talking about the audience, I'm talking about the Süddeutsche Zeitung, Frankfurter Allgemeine, I mean, these are really big journals. In France, Libération and Cahiers du Cinéma, Cahiers du Cinéma is a very important professional monthly, they were putting down, Le Monde was putting up. So it's not, you know, it really splits sometimes the opinions. Andy, I finished, imagine.